Good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to welcome our today's speaker, Per Fehmer from University of Veras. And he'll be talking on high transitive groups among groups on trees. Before starting with the talk, I request you all to keep your audio on mute. There will be a question answer session at the end. Nevertheless, if you want to ask any question, please do it on chat or use the raise hand feature and wait for a signal from our coordinator, Dr. Ihsan Patri, before unmuting your audio. And so welcome, Pierre, and we can start.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Ihsan, for the invitation. So I'm going to speak about a joint work with François Lemaître, So-Young Moon, and Yves Stalder. So here is the plan of the talk. I will first speak about, give you some definitions and obvious examples of high transitivity, highly transitive action and groups. Then I will give you some insight on groups acting on trees. And I will speak about important results about asymmetrically hyperbolic groups, and then about some results about linear groups. Then I will come back in more details on groups acting on trees. And finally, I will give you some new highly transitive groups. So some notations first. So this double inclusion, A inside B, means that A is a finite subset of B. The symbol X here will be used for a countable, infinite countable set. This symbol S of X is the group of bijections of X. I view this this group of bijection with the topology of pointwise convergence. And concretely, with this topology, a subset G in S of X is dense if and only if, for all bijection sigma in S of X, for all finite subset F in X, there exists a G in G such that the G on F acts like sigma on this subset F. So, easy example of a dense countable subgroup. So this is a dense subset, and this is also a subgroup. This is the set of bijection with a finite support. Means that there exists a finite set such that outside this finite set, the bijection acts like the identity. Okay, so let's speak about high transitivity. So given a non-negative integer k, this set x to the power k, so x is always this given infinite countable set, x to the power k like this. This is a set of k tuples with pairwise disjoint coordinates. Pairwise distinct coordinates. Okay. So now an action alpha of group gamma on X is called K transitive if for any K tuples, pair of tuples, some XI, some YA with R, so pairwise distinct, there exists one element G in gamma which maps XI on YI for all I. And now this action here is called highly transitive if it's K transitive for all K. Okay. So what is easy to see from the definition I gave you before of the topology is that an action is actually highly transitive if and only if the image of alpha in the group of bijections of X is dense. And definition is of a highly transitive group is the following. So the group is highly transitive if there is some highly transitive and faithful action. So it means that this is isomorphic to a dense subgroup of the group of bijection. Okay. So let me give you some easy example. The group of, I was talking about this group before. So this group of finitely supported bijection, this group is highly transitive. Also the group of finitely transitive permutation, even and finitely supported permutation, this is highly transitive. And so let me give you some definition before going to some obstruction to high transitivity. So a group gamma is called ICC if all its conjugate cyclases except the trivial one, they are infinite. And this group gamma is called solvable if the sequence of derived subgroup is stationary at some point, it's always the trivial group. Okay, here I explain what is the sequence of derived subgroup. So the derived subgroup of gamma is the group generated by the commutators in gamma. And a group is called virtually solvable if some finite index subgroup is solvable. So example of solvable subgroup, these are, for example, abelian groups. Okay, the group of commutators is generated by commutator is trivial. So now if so about the non-examples, if a group is highly transitive, then every non-trivial normal subgroup has to, and every finite index subgroup has to be highly transitive, and the group itself has to be ICC and not solvable. So for the proof of this result, it actually follows from the fact that this topological group S of X is topologically simple, means that every closed normal subgroup is either trivial, either one or S of X. So for example, if you want to prove that every normal subgroup is highly transitive, you take so a highly transitive group. So you can view, because the action is failed, as a subgroup of S of X, and because the action is highly transitive, you can view it as a dense subgroup of S of X. So now if I take a normal subgroup, then the closure of this closure of this group, it will be normal in the closure of gamma, so in S of X. And because S of X is topologically simple, this group has to be either trivial or dense. So a non-trivial normal subgroup will be dense and highly transitive. So for a finite index subgroup, H in gamma, if it is finite index, then I can find a normal subgroup in a subgroup in of H which is normal in gamma and has finite index in gamma. Then this subgroup, since it has finite index, it cannot be trivial, because then gamma will be finite and then it cannot be highly transitive. So by one, n has to be dense, and because n is dense and in H itself has to be dense. So H is highly transitive. And now using point one and two, we can prove it's not difficult to deduce that gamma has to be ICC and not virtually solvable. Okay, so let me explain some more interesting examples. So the first non-trivial example, it has been observed by McDonough in 77 and Dixon in 90. Non-abelian free groups, they are all highly transitive. Glass and McLearly in 91, Gunhouse in 92, and Ekin in 92, so this Gunhouse, he was a student of McClearly, I think. So with these two reasons, they managed to prove that, to characterize which free non-trivial free products are really transitive. And then the same year, in 92, Eakin gave a totally different proof of the same result. So they show that free product, G free product with H is highly transitive, if and only if G or H is not, has not size two, size, I mean, by, and not one, because by non-trivial free product here, I mean that both G and H are non-trivial groups. So this result has been rediscovered and with a different proof and some improvement also by Moon and Stalder in 2012. And
both are the two element groups, then I guess the free product is not ICC, right? So that part was...
No, it's not. Yeah, actually, this is also equivalent to say that this statement here is equivalent to say that gamma, the free product is ICC. So the only case when this is not ICC is for a non-trivial free product is this case. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
This is called the... Okay. This is... okay, so yeah, everything here is equivalent to say that G free product H is ICC. Okay, so another interesting example is the one given by Kit Rother in 2009. There are surface groups. He shows that surface groups are highly transitive. So for surface groups, there are fundamental groups of surface sigma G of genre G at least two. Then Garion and Glasner in 2011, they show that the out of Fn is highly transitive for n larger than 4. Out of Fn here is the quotient of the group of automorphism of Fn by quotiented by the normal subgroup of inner automorphisms. And then Shenikov in 2012 showed that non-elementary hyperbolic groups without finite normal subgroups are highly transitive. Okay, so let me explain some basic stuff about groups acting on trees. So the first example of a group acting on a tree is an amalgamated free product. So let's sigma is a common subgroup of gamma 1 and gamma 2, two groups, gamma 1, gamma 2. And gamma is the amalgamated free product of gamma 1, gamma 2 with amalgamation over sigma. It means that this is the group generated by, it has gamma 1 and gamma 2 as subgroups, and it is the group generated by gamma 1 and gamma 2 with the relation that the copy of sigma in gamma 1 is identified with the copy of sigma in gamma 2. So now such a group, it acts on a tree. The tree is called the Basser tree of gamma. So what is this tree? The vertices of this tree is the disjoint union of gamma mod gamma 1 with gamma mod gamma 2. And the positive edges of this tree, so it has some natural orientation, and the positive edges, they are the class, the gamma mod sigma. And now if I take basic edge, G sigma, basic positive edge, G sigma, so its source, this will be G gamma 1, and its range, this will be G gamma 2. So this is a tree, and gamma acts on this tree by left translation on vertices and on edges. There is another basic example of a group acting on a tree, an HNN extension. So what is an HNN extension? The data is a subgroup sigma of H and some injective group homomorphism from sigma to H, theta. And the HNN extension of this data, H sigma theta, is just the group generated by H plus some extra generator T, which makes theta in. And from this group, I can build a T on which gamma acts, called the Basser tree of the HNN extension. So the vertices of this tree, this is the class gamma mod H. And the edges are the disjoint union of gamma mod sigma and gamma mod theta of sigma. So positive edges here, they are gamma mod sigma, and negative edges, gamma. And the source range and inversion maps of a basic edge G sigma, positive edge G sigma, they are given by, so the source of G sigma is GH. The range of G sigma is GTH, and the inverse of G sigma is G theta of sigma. I can also give you then the source and range of G theta of sigma. Source of G theta of sigma is GH, and the range of G theta of sigma is GT minus 1 H. So this gives a tree, and gamma act on this tree by left translation on both vertices and edges. Okay, so let me explain some Basser theory now. So I will call a tree non-trivial when it has at least two edges, so E and its opposite edge E bar. And an action gamma on a tree T is without inversion if any element of G, no element of G can map one edge on its positive edge, on its opposite edge. So what is easy to check is that the two examples I give you, the action of an amalgamated free product on its Basser tree, or the action of an HNN extension on its Basser tree, these two actions are without inversion. And actually, they are the main example, the only examples of action without inversion. This is what is called the Sears dévissage. Any group acting without inversion on a non-trivial tree is either a non-trivial amalgamated free product or a non-trivial HNN extension. Okay, so we know almost all examples of action of group acting on trees. And now I will try to explain what kind of group acting on trees are known to be highly transitive. So first, let me notice the core of a subgroup. So if I take sigma subgroup if in H, what is called the core of sigma in H is the kernel of the action of H on H mod sigma. So this is exactly this kernel, the intersection for H in big H of H minus 1 sigma H. And subgroup sigma in H is called core free if its core, okay, is trivial. So it means that the action of H on H mod sigma is faithful. So now I need to explain some technical notion, the notion of highly core-free subgroup. It's not so important to understand it now. This is just to give a precise statement later. So I need this notion of relative core now for a subset S in H. The core of sigma relative to S, this will be at the intersection of H minus 1 sigma H for H in S. And the sub sigma is called highly core-free if the following holds. So for any finite covering of H up to some finitely many sigma classes, there exists one element of this covering, some SK, such that the relative core of sigma relative to SK is trivial. So let me give you just some examples. So highly core-free subgroup are core-free. And there are core-free subgroups which are not highly core-free. The example is this one. If I take the group of finitely supported bijection of X, and I take any point in X, let's say X naught, then the subgroup the finitely supported bijection which stabilized X naught, this subgroup is core-free, but is not highly core-free. An example, the example of core-free, the trivial group in any group H, and a non-trivial subgroup sigma is highly core-free, implies that it has infinite index. So here are some examples. So if AICC, then any finite subgroup of H is highly core-free. Now, if H is infinite and sigma is a malnormal subgroup and finite, then sigma is highly core-free. So malnormal means that sigma intersects with G sigma G minus 1 is always trivial for G not in sigma. So it's some kind of opposite to normality. And now some other example, if H again is infinite and sigma is abelian, malnormal, and has infinite index. So for example, here in examples of these situations, for example, if H is the free product of sigma abelian with J non-trivial, or H is the semi-direct product of K star acting by multiplication on K, where K is an infinite field, and then you take sigma the K star, the non-zero element of this field. Now let me give you the main theorem from a work from 2015 in collaboration with Soyoung Moon and Yves Stalder. So we showed there that if a group acts without inversion in trivial tree, and if for any edge E with endpoint V, the stabilizer of, so for any, let's say for any vertex V, the stabilizer of V is infinite, and for any edge E, the stabilizer of E inside as a subgroup of the stabilizer of its endpoint, so either the source of the range of E, then inside this group, this is highly core-free. Then under this condition, the group itself is highly transitive. So some obvious corollary from the examples I gave you before is that if gamma acts without inversion on a non-trivial tree with ICC vertex stabilizers and finite edge stabilizers, then gamma has to be highly transitive. Okay, so now I will speak a little about acylindrically hyperbolic groups and make the relation with highly transitive groups. So let me give you the definition of what is an acylindrically hyperbolic group. So again, the definition is slightly technical. There is no really need to understand fully this definition. This is only to give a precise statement later. Group gamma is called acylindrically hyperbolic if it has an isometric and non-elementary acylindrically action on a hyperbolic space S. So here, non-elementary means that for one orbit or any orbit, this is equivalent, gamma orbit, there are infinitely many elements in the Gromov boundary of S, which are limits of sequences in this gamma orbit. And cylindrical means that for any positive epsilon, there is some R and some N, such that for any pair of element XY, which are at distance at least R, then there are at most n element G of gamma, which maps X to an element at distance at most epsilon, and Y to an element at most epsilon, at distance at most epsilon. So let me give you some examples. So the point is that acylindrically hyperbolic groups, there are many groups which are acylindrically hyperbolic. So for example, the first thing is that this is a generalization of non-elementary hyperbolic groups, and also of many hyperbolic groups. Many groups acting on K0 spaces are acylindrically hyperbolic. Many mapping class groups are out of Fn is also for n bigger, larger than 2. Many three manifold groups and also got efficiency at least 2. So here, these are some finitely presented groups. Okay, so it covers many different classes of groups, and the result of Minaya Yasan and Ozin in 2015. So the first one is related to which kind of group acting on trees are acylindrically hyperbolic. So they are the groups acting minimally on a tree T without fixed point on the boundary, and such that for there exists some vertices U and V such that the intersection of the stabilizer of U and the stabilizer of V is finite. Then such groups, they are either virtually cyclic or acylindrically hyperbolic. Here, so I should say virtually cyclic means that some finite index subgroup is cyclic, and minimal, the action on a tree is minimal if there is no non-trivial globally gamma invariant subtree. Okay, so so the corollary of this theorem is that this kind of group acting on trees are acylindrically hyperbolic. So first, a non-trivial free product gamma one free product gamma two is acylindrically hyperbolic if gamma 1 and gamma 2 have size larger than 2. If gamma 1 or gamma 2 have size larger than 3. Okay, so they do not have both size 2. So in this case, this case is virtually cyclic. And if gamma act without inversion on a non-trivial tree, with ICC vertex stabilizer and finite edge stabilizer, then this gamma is acylindrically hyperbolic. So I wrote this example here because this is the corollary I gave you just before about high transitivity. And so what is important for us is that Hull and Ozin, they showed that any acylindrically hyperbolic group has a highly transitive action on a countable set with a finite kernel. So if you ask, moreover, that this acylindrically hyperbolic group does not have any non-trivial finite normal subgroup, then gamma is highly transitive. Okay, so this result is very strong because it gives many new highly transitive group, and all the examples they are actually acylindrically hyperbolic, and you can prove high transitivity by using this result. Okay, so now different result about linear groups. So Gelander, Glasner, and Seufer, they proved very recently in 2019 that if K is a local field and gamma is a subgroup of SL2K with a trivial center and an unbounded subgroup. So I should say unbounded here, it has a meaning because local field, so it has an absolute value, and so in SL2K I have a norm and I can speak about unbounded subgroup. So if this subgroup satisfies this hypothesis, then what is important for us is that is the 2 and 3, because one, I did not explain what it means to be Zariski dense. But what is important for us is that gamma is highly transitive if and only if it is not virtually solvable. So this is something easy to check for a linear group of this kind if it is or not highly transitive. Okay, so now I will come back a little on a group acting on trees. So I will give you some definitions here. So I take a tree T, and I need a notion of boundary. So the boundary of T, it's the set of infinite geodesic paths. It's the set of equivalence classes, I should say, of infinite geodesic paths for the equivalence relation of being. So I identify two infinite geodesic paths if they coincide outside a finite set. So I should say if their image in the tree coincides outside a finite set. So if you want an element on the boundary, it's a direction of an infinite geodesic path in T. So it comes, this boundary, with a natural compact topology and a group homomorphism from the automorphism of T to the homeomorphism of the boundary of T. So any action of group gamma on T will give an action by homeomorphism of gamma on the boundary of T. Now, an automorphism of T is called hyperbolic if it acts by a non-trivial translation on some b-infinite geodesic paths. Such a b-infinite geodesic path on which G act as a non-trivial translation is called its axis. And then the axis will give an element on the boundary if I take the equivalent class of it. And because G acts as a translation on the axis, then the element on the boundary will be a fixed point for G. A gamma action on T now is called of general type if gamma contains two hyperbolic automorphisms on T with no common fixed point on the boundary. And gamma action on T is called minimal if there is no non-trivial invariant subtree. So I'm going to give you some examples of such minimal and general type action on trees. So let's go back to our favorite examples of amalgamated free products and HNN extension. So if I take an amalgamated free product and I look at the action on its Bassert tree, then this action is of general type if and only if the amalgamated free product is non-degenerate. This means that so gamma 1 is not sigma, gamma 2 is not sigma, and some of these two, gamma 1 or gamma 2, for some j, sigma has to have index at least 3 in some gamma j. And for most of the amalgamated free product, the action on the Bassert tree is of general type. And also for most of HNN extension, the action of the Bassert tree is of general type. So it's of general type if and only if the HNN extension is what is called non-ascending. This means that H is not sigma and is also not theta of sigma. And this action, they are always minimal. Okay, so let's go through another definition before I explained our main result. So gamma action on a topological space X is called topologically free if for any non-trivial element G in gamma, the set of fixed point of G has empty interior. And so what we showed in the common joint work with François Lemaître, So Young Moon, Yves Stalder in early this year, is that if gamma acts as a minimal general type action on a non-trivial tree T, this is automatic. The tree will be automatically non-trivial if I ask the action to be of general type. So I don't have to assume this is non-trivial. This is automatic. Then if the boundary action, the action of gamma on the boundary of T is topologically free, then gamma has to be highly transitive. Okay, so first let's see in our examples of amalgamated free products and HNN extension. Let's see what are the statements. So I will give you some corollary replacing the statement of topological freeness by something simpler to understand. But this corollary is much stronger than the theorem I mentioned before. So first, this is a reminder of what I explained before in this result in 2015, and then I will give you a corollary of this theorem in this setting. So I take an amalgamated free product of gamma 1, gamma 2 over sigma with gamma 1, gamma 2 infinite. So what I explained before is that if sigma is highly core-free in both gamma 1, gamma 2, then gamma has to be highly transitive. And if I take an HNN extension, non-ascending with H infinite, if sigma and theta of sigma are highly core-free in H, then gamma is highly transitive. Now, corollary of this theorem from 2020 is this one. So I take a non-degenerate amalgamated free product, and I assume that sigma is core-free and not highly core-free, only core-free not in both either gamma 1 and gamma 2, but in either gamma 1 or gamma 2. Then it's easy to check that the action of gamma on the boundary of this Bass tree is topologically free. So by the previous theorem, gamma is highly transitive. And so you see the difference. So I assume sigma only core-free and not highly core-free, and either in gamma 1, in gamma 2, and not both in gamma 1, gamma 2. And here, this is similar. If I take a non-ascending HNN extension, if I assume sigma or theta of sigma core-free in H, and not both core-free, and only core-free and not highly core-free, then the action of gamma on the boundary of the Bassert tree is topologically free, so gamma is highly transitive. So this is a huge improvement of this corollary. And so now let me show you how this theorem I mentioned is sharp. So first, let me recall what is the transitivity degree of a group. So the transitivity degree of gamma, this is defined as the supremum of the integer n larger than 1, such that gamma has a faithful and n-transitive action. So when gamma is highly transitive, the transitivity of degree of gamma is infinity. But, however, the converse is open. So now I want to mention a very important result is the this theorem from Adrien Le Boudec and Thomas Matebon from 2019. So suppose that gamma acts on a tree T and the action is faithful, minimal, and of general type. Then they show that if the action of gamma on the boundary of T is not topologically free, then the transitivity degree of gamma is less than 3. So it shows how our results are sharp. It shows that we have the following corollary from our result and this result of Le Boudec and Matebon. So we have a dichotomy. So I take an action gamma on a tree T, which is faithful, minimal, of general type. And I have the following dichotomy. So either one is that gamma, the action of gamma is on the boundary of T is topologically free. And this is equivalent to gamma being highly transitive and the transitivity degree of gamma being infinity. Or two, the action of gamma on the boundary of T is not topologically free, and this is equivalent to gamma being not highly transitive and the topological degree of gamma being less than 3. So you see here that this is this condition of the boundary action being topologically free. This is the sharpest high transitivity, and also it gives a new class of group for which the equivalence between high transitivity and transitivity degree of being infinity is true. Okay, because this is open, and for this class of group the equivalence is true. Okay, so now it's time to explain some new examples of highly transitive groups. So the main example is given by this class of Bohm-Slack solitaire groups. So these groups, the Bohm-Slack solitaire groups, they depends on two parameters, which are non-zero, non-negative integers. And the group BS of MN, so this is the group generated by A and B, with the relation a b to the m a minus 1 is b to the n. These groups, they are known to be metabelian if absolute value of m is 1 or absolute value of n is 1. Non-amenable if absolute value of m and absolute value of n is larger than 2. And ICC if and only if absolute value of M is not equal to absolute value of N. Linear if and only if either absolute value of M is 1 or absolute value of N is 1 or absolute value of M is equal to absolute value of N. And they are always not acylindrically hyperbolic. Okay, so the question, so in this work from Hull and Ozin about high transitivity of acylindrically hyperbolic groups, they ask about Bohm-Slack solitaire group because they could not, they are not acylindrically hyperbolic. So what is known and what is not easy from all I said here is that if we are not in this situation, so the situation absolute value of m and absolute value of n larger than 2 and absolute value of m different for absolute value of n, this is the situation when we can ask what is the transitivity degree of Bohm-Slack solitaire group of parameter n m n, because in any other situation the transitivity degree is known to be 1. So this is what they ask, and what is very well known is that the Bohm-Slack solitaire group with parameter m and n is actually an HNN extension, And the action on its path set tree is topologically free if and only if the absolute value of M is not equal to the absolute value of N. So we can apply our theorem and show that this is highly transitive if and only if we are in this situation. So it gives an answer to this question of Hull and Ozin. And so this result of Hull and Ozin could not apply because they are not asymmetrically hyperbolic. They are not linear, so also the result about linearity could not apply. And our result about high transitivity, about high transitivity in the context of highly core-free subgroup also could not apply in this situation. So there are really new examples. So from this class of examples, you can, cooked up some other new examples. So let me explain how to do that. So if you take, I will write to I will use this notation now and see S infinity of X inside S of X for the subgroup of finitely supported bijections. And I will give you a list of groups which are highly transitive, but they are not linear, not acylindrically hyperbolic. And also we cannot use the, my previous result related to highly core-free subgroups. So this group here, which is the amalgamated free product of BSMN and lambda over the subgroup, some cyclic subgroup. This is over cyclic subgroup generated by C, if I view this subgroup inside lambda, or B to the K, if I view this cyclic subgroup inside BS of MN. So, the condition is that BS of MN is highly transitive. So we are in this specific situation about on the parameters MNN. And K is not zero. And the subgroup generated by C inside lambda is a proper subgroup and is S normal. So I can take lambda equals Z and C equal 2, for example. S normal here means that sigma G minus 1 intersection with sigma is always infinite for all G in lambda. So this is an example of new example of highly transitive group. Another new example is this one, this amalgamated free product, S infinity of X amalgamated with S infinity of X over the stabilizer of some point X naught. Examples of HNN extension also. So I take this HNN extension, S infinity of Y inside S infinity of X. So what is the, how I view this inclusion? So Y is a infinite and co-infinite subset of X. So I can view the finitely supported permutation of Y with finite support inside Y inside the finitely supported permutation of X. So this is the natural inclusion. And then the injective group homomorphism theta is given by this one. So I take any bijective map from Y to Z where Z is a subset of X and theta is an injective group homomorphism constructed in this way, map sigma to tau minus 1 sigma tau. And if I ask Y and Z to be both infinite and co-infinite, meaning that the complement in X is also infinite, then this HNN extension is highly transitive. And also we can cook up some finite tap examples from these ones. Okay, so I give you now some bibliography. So the first five papers here, they are the one the main results I spoke about are in these five papers. And I mentioned also for people who are interested, the two other papers where we provide some generalizations in different contexts of some of the results I spoke about here. Okay, so this is the end now. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Per. Any questions?
Yeah.
Anyone wants to ask any question?
Actually, I want to ask one question.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So I'm Riddhi. I want to know if there is any relation between these highly transitive groups and, say, property T or hard group property or.
So I don't know any. I mean, if you think that property T can. Property T can be an obstruction to high transitivity. This is not because many hyperbolic groups are.
Sorry, I can't hear because there's a plane passing on overhead. Yeah.
Okay.
Can you repeat what you said? Sorry.
Yeah, sorry. So I don't know any relation, and for sure this is not an obstruction to be highly transitive, to have property T. Because almost all hyperbolic groups are highly transitive, and many hyperbolic groups also have property T. So this is clearly not an obstruction. So you have highly transitive group with property T for sure. And that's it. I don't know any relation, actually.
The same for Hager group property also. So the free products, etc., will have Hager group property. So
yeah.
Yeah, thanks.
So, Pierre, what is the obstruction to this acylindrically hyperbolic? For example, why do the Baumschlag solitaire groups not have this property?
So, this is because they have. So, what is. Okay, so what is important if that. So there are not acylindrically group hyperbolic group are. Let me. You still see my screen, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So. So what is important is that S normal subgroup of an acylindrically group is S normal, acylindrically hyperbolic, and any acylindrically hyperbolic group is not amenable. Okay, and so what you show is that for example, the subgroup generated. I don't remember exactly if it is the one generated by A or the one generated by B. Or B to the M or B to the N, I don't know. One of this one is S normal in the Baumschlag solitaire group. And so it has to be if BSMN is acylindrically hyperbolic, this subgroup has to be. Acylindrically hyperbolic, but this one is always, abelian, so amenable and cannot be acylindrically hyperbolic. So this is the way you do it. Okay.
And what about lattices, like high rank lattices? Do you know? So they will have by which property if are they highly transitive or is it known?
A group acting on such, you mean?
SLNZ.
Oh, lattice. Sorry.
SLNZ.
Lattice. Yeah. It is not known, and this one is a important question. Okay, so what the only thing I know is this SL2
SL2 will be have finite free group as finite index, so that will be okay.
Yeah. So the only thing I know is this theorem of when I spoke about linearity, and for SLNZ, so this is totally open, and so I tried, SL3Z at least, and so for now I have no idea how to check if it is highly transitive or not.
Okay. Thanks.
Any more questions?
I jotted some things in the chat.
Ma'am, you can ask.
Okay. One thing was that George Willis has good work on groups with the infinite conjugacy classes, and he gave a great talk at topological group seminars. And that talk might be available, so the organizer can be asked. Second was a trivial question regarding Baumschlag Shapiro Slater groups. When you take MN, you would take HCF is one, and they are not factors or some things like that. You will impose conditions.
Sorry, I didn't get it.
You are denoting BS group, BSMN. So
yes.
would you take HCF of MN N to be one? And minimum such pair also.
No, I mean, I think this is for any M and any N. So there's no necessity, no...
But you see, it is that A, B, M is B and A. That means A commutes with different powers. So if commutes with different powers, then multiples will automatically commute.
So yeah, if M is equal to N, so this is a case where A commutes with B to the M. So this case is...
I mean, some kind of minimum condition would you put, or is it needed or not?
Yeah, so if I want high transitivity, so as I was explaining here, I need this condition, is that absolute value of M and absolute value of N is larger than 2. But what is important relative to what you are saying, is that absolute value of M is not equal to absolute value of N. So in particular, M is different from N, and A will not commute with any power of B, actually.
Oh, so these MN, there will be single solution for MN?
There is no condition, as far as I know, on MN. It could be any...
No condition, you see, there is A, B, M is B and A.
Yeah.
The generators have condition in terms of MN.
No, they
are... Doesn't matter.
Just see that condition. You put that A, B, N, A inverse is A, B, M, yeah. A inverse is B, N. That means commuting condition, na?
No, it does not commute. If M is different from N,
it is generated by A and B, which satisfy this condition.
Yeah, but they don't commute if M and N are different.
M and N are different.
There. I mean, A, B, M is a B and A, that I know. That is why different solutions for such a commuting thing can come or not.
So I didn't get exactly the question. So sorry, I didn't exactly understand your question.
Okay, that's all right. I just wondered whether the MN will be uniquely determined by this condition or not. That is all.
So M and N, they are given. Okay. They are fixed, and then I define a group from it.
I mean, for instance, if MN, can there be more solutions for such a commuting relation or not?
Ajit, it gives different groups for different values of M and N. So.
Okay.
So the group, if you want, the group that BSMN is isomorphic to BS M prime N prime. So I think this is if and only if... M is plus minus N, M prime, and N is plus minus N prime, something like that. And you can exchange also both N and M. BSMN is isomorphic to BSNM, And also BSMN is isomorphic to BS minus M minus N. It depends only on the absolute value, and also not there is no order on M and N.
You see, if you take MN equal to 1, then AB is BA, and therefore all further solutions are also there. So some minimum condition has got to be put. That is my point.
Okay. So, yeah, I don't know.
Because you are only saying Z minus 0. So take M and N both to be 1. Then for all MN, commuting condition is there for all powers, you know. The commuting condition.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, yeah, so some minimality condition has to be there on the pair MN.
No, it defines the group, and under this condition, there is...
Take M and N equal to 1 in your condition on line 2.
So if you are M alloying, and N equals 1...
Which you are alloying because you are only taking Z minus 0. So take M and N both 1. That means the condition is AB is BA.
Yeah.
And A and B commute. So then A commutes with all powers of B also then.
Yeah. So if M equals N equals 1, then this group is Z2. And this group, this is not in the...
So if MN equal to 1, then it's a solution. Further, MN's equal are also solutions. So you have to put some minimality condition.
The group generated by A and B such that A commute with B, this is Z2, and this is what is written here. Okay, when M equals N equals 1. I don't see exactly your point, but... If I take M equals N equals 1, I have the group generated by A and B such that A and B commutes. This is the definition of Z to the power 2.
Appear anything known about their sister or von Neumann algebras? Not Baumschmidt solider. I mean general of the group you are talking.
Relative to A transitivity?
Relative to the new groups that you show.
Yeah. I'm not aware about any results. And I didn't work on it. I don't know if it is some. I'm not sure this notion of high transitivity. I don't think this is a notion of the sister algebra or of the von Neumann algebra. I don't know if it implies something on it. I have no idea actually, but this is an interesting question. This is something to look at, I guess.
Yeah, that's what Ishan was saying, that Pierre may be already trying this. That's why I asked.
I didn't try.
Yeah. So if no more questions are there, maybe we can thank the speaker. So thank you, Pierre.
Thank you.